Okay, I'm actually quite thrilled and quite speechless after Siddharth's talk, and I should also thank Shweta to cover and scoop much of my talk already. So, we perhaps know that we are all magnetic. The story begins like more than a billion years before, when two basic principles of Earth governed the way that life came out to be. One was the rotation that caused cyclic photoperiodism, and the other was dipole magnet. Nature somehow came up with a brilliant solution as a one-step solution to combine both the effects and to create a common receptor for either processes. These cryoproteins are cryptochromes, largely called so because of the cryptogenic color that it gives, and also from the cryptogames that are the plants in which they were studied first. Other than the cryptochromes that you see here, there are phytochromes and phototropins that actually respond to the blue light or red light, and they can cause and respond to the photoperiodism. However, the cryptochromes were rather strange when they were first seen to respond against the magnetic field as well. And the way that they do is what Shweta already covered. They are the molecules that would have a pocket site where basically flavin, adenosine, dinucleotide would come and bind, which is a adenine moiety with a isoalexanine ring, and this undergoes differential states of oxidation and reduction, because of which it eventually causes the conformational change. So basically the FAD is flanked by three tryptophan moieties, and all three of them actually respond to the magnetic field. So each electron basically has a moment, a dipole moment, and it also has a magnetic field which gets disrupted even with the slightest of perturbations that are there. And this is the figure which you already saw some time back. And so essentially what happens is between these states, the response to magnetic field is quick. But then the major problem was, for this to happen, the molecule should be immobilized. For any detector to detect the electron or to detect the magnetic spin, the moiety should be largely immobilized. And that's how, although cryptochromes are, you know, they are conserved across the entire animal kingdom, from plants to humans to Drosophila to all other model organisms that you can talk of, in birds, people speculate that they are more immobilized. And the way that they are is they are stacked between the disc cells of retina by some sterol linkages. And while rhodopsin is a molecule that can respond to blue light and is pretty much immobilized in the membrane itself, cryptochrome, although being cytoplasmic, still has a rigid rotational degree of freedom, thereby acting as a perfect sensor. Perhaps if this immobilization is happening also in humans, we might be able to navigate like birds from north-south, or you know how it happens. The other magnetic receptors that we have in the system are largely unknown. But what we do have is something that can cause magnetism, that is the magnetite ions. So if you would know, magnetite ores are the ores that are very highly ferromagnetic. The moment you you basically expose the magnetite molecules to magnets, within 15 to 20 minutes they can become permanent magnets. And these magnetite crystals were found in brain samples after postmortem in multiple humans, and it was acquired in the Bavarian forest, which is 80 kilometers from Munich in Germany. And basically this map shows the deposition of magnetite crystals somehow in frontal cerebrum as well as cerebellum, and this was strange. So basically what they did was to understand the saturation isothermal remanent magnetization, which is to understand the net spin of the total magnetite ions that are present in a given vessel or container, and in this case it was brain. So till now we had talked about magnetoreception. More than that, there are other aspects of magnetism that lies with biology, and those are magnetobiology and biomagnetism. I would later also come down to magnetotherapies. So magnetobiology is the branch that would include magnetoreception, but more to it, it would also tell you how this magnetoreception can perturb with your life. So we know that cryoproteins are also part of photoperiodism, and they are also a part of circadian rhythm. These cryptochromes interact with the period proteins, the PER1, PER2, and these were discovered in Drosophila. And then you also have mouse model in which again you see homologs, and these are conserved throughout. And even in this, you know that there are these cryptochrome 1 and 2 proteins that would interact with this, and they are essentially the yin-yang cycle that would give you a feedback loop upon day and night. Now since these cryptochromes are there, people speculated, and Kirchevin's group actually had done this experiment where he made people sit in room and then the magnetism was altered and their response was seen. And overall the effect is such that the cry1 and cry2 protein are also involved in neurodegeneration, and perhaps altering the magnetic field can give you symptomatic relief to much of these problems that you see in these kind of disorders, which include dementia and disorientation while walking and other such things. So with that, I'll take you back to 1971, where first time Professor David Cohen dared to actually make a device where he can take human guinea pigs, make them sit in the container and record their brain activity. The way that he would do is by using something which is called superconducting quantum interference device, quite a big jargon which I'll be explaining. And this is he retired way back in 1993, but is still active in the lab. And this is the pattern that you would get upon understanding the magnetic radiation that is coming out of the body. So the most prominent magnetic device that we often encounter in medical field is the magnetic resonance imaging. And so here I want to make this clear that how it is different than MRI. So in an MRI, what happens is basically your body is full of photons. Imagine it like a playground where random school kids are just running around. But then there's a school principal, which is this magnet, huge magnet, that asks you to be in the line. Now there's another person. Now when you are in the line, you are basically aligned with the magnetic field, right? Because each photon has its own electron and photon's spin. Now what you do is you perturb this perpendicularly with a radio wave source. The moment you do, the photons actually shift, and the moment they shift, you basically give them pulses of this radio waves. So it's like you're pushing that guy from the line, and then guy is shouting, "Hey, why are you pushing me?" Right? And this shout that the guy is making in a school line comes out in the form of resonance that is detected by the receptor. And that's what the magnetic resonance imaging is all about. Whereas superconducting quantum interference device tells you about the actual magnetic field that is produced inside the body. And the way that it does is, what Shweta was explaining about the quantum tunneling, you essentially have electrons, you flow electricity via thin insulator. So it's not that the electrons will bounce back, they will slowly seep through this insulator. But then there are these magnetic field lines that are generated as a result of flow of electricity. The moment it catches even tiny bit of perturbation in this electricity, these arms become asymmetric. The moment the electricity in these two arms of the coil becomes asymmetric, you have a voltage flux. All that you had to do is to now detect this voltage flux and tell you that what kind of magnetic field line is coming out of your body. So with this, I'll take you to the fact that this quid-based detection can go as low as 10 to the power minus 18 Tesla, which is atto-Tesla unit. And it is far lesser than what you see in the Earth's magnetic field, which is around 50 microteslas. And so it's highly sensitive, and our human brain was seen to detect the alpha waves at around 10 to the power minus 13. So around pico to nano Tesla level is what humans can detect. And David Cohen could show, and he could make the device that can detect the brain magnetic field lines quite easily. So the current machine looks something like this, not the UFO that you saw some slides before. And there's another machine that now has, just like how you have electroencephalogram, you also have magnetoencephalogram, which basically nerve impulses are running in form of ion channels, and as they are running with electrophysiological gradient formation, they would also produce the perpendicular field of magnetic lines. And these magnetic lines are emerging from the brain, which is detected by 306 grid quadrant helmet like an aperture, and each aperture is basically a squid device. So each squid device will pick the signal and can tell you the tiniest of perturbation that are happening in the magnetic field. So essentially it looks something like this, still UFO, but maybe a better hat. What is the advantage of using such a device? It's something like 2D gel electrophoresis. With electrophoresis, you know that you can separate out proteins based on the molecular weight. But when you add a PI and pH differentiation, now you can actually resolve much better. Same thing happens when you combine MEG and EEG. You actually get a butterfly plot where you can pin down to a single neuron electromagnetic flux. And with this single neuron electromagnetic flux, the actual data looks like this. So whereas in EEG you see very tiny perturbations happening in neurons that can be prognostic to episodes of seizures and epilepsy, combining it with MEG gives you better resolution of pinning it down to the neuron that is actually responsible for giving you the disorder, right? And so it's more of a prognostic measure, and people are also now using it to detect unipolar, bipolar disorders and schizophrenia with much more accuracy than was speculated before. I'll take you to the magnetotherapies now. So the three different types of magnetotherapies that are by and large in use is transcranial magnetic stimulation. Now that you know that magnetic field lines are coming out of your brain, now you can also stimulate them, you can also alter them. So minor magnetic field of around 0.03 tesla is given. So by the way, MRI uses 0.5 to 1.5 tesla. So even in that limits, we are still using lesser magnetic field lines to actually perturb the brain. There is something which is called repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation that people give to see how these magnetic field lines can be changed for treatments of different disorders. So by and large, TMS is used for medication for chronic depression. Magnetic seizure therapy is used for people suffering from epilepsies and other seizures. And magnetoconvulsive therapy, just like electroconvulsive therapy, is given to patients who are suffering from psychological disorders. And major problem with the electroconvulsive therapies is that most of the patients would suffer from memory loss of some or the other kind, which is around 75%. With this therapy, the recovery rate was more than 84%. So a significant improvement in the loss of memory was seen, apart from the remission of the schizophrenia symptoms. And this can putatively be used to treat dementia or neurodegenerative disorders. With that, I thank you all, and these are the references that you can go through, a huge list of references.